Right now, I feel a little overwhelmed. Right now, I could really use some help. Right now, I don't feel like it is well with my soul. I've tried to find a way around the mess. I've prayed in faith that the night would end right here when I just can't understand. I lift my hands, hallelujah, when the storm is relentless, hallelujah, when the battle is endless, in the middle of the in-between, in the middle of the questioning, over every worry, every fear, hallelujah, even here. And my heart gets free. Too far, too hard becomes so easy. I find peace here in surrendering and letting go. Hallelujah, when the storm is relentless, hallelujah, when the battle.
Good evening, everyone. You are extremely welcome to this gathering of Ballynahinch Baptist Church. This evening is a very special evening service. It's a special evening service as we set aside and commit Matthew Reid to the role of assistant pastor of this church. And we will do that seeking God's help and God's blessing. I want to give a warm welcome this evening to Matthew's family and friends, those who've joined us this evening to show their support. And I trust for you this service will be a real blessing and encouragement. I also want this evening to welcome our brothers and sisters in Christ from Dungannon Baptist Church. Matthew served there for around 6 years, and it's great that you could join us tonight. I know you cancelled your evening service to travel down and to be here, and we know that that means a lot to Matthew. And finally, I want to give a big welcome to the regulars, the Ballynahinch Church family. This is a very special occasion for us, and it's really good for you to come this evening to show your support for Matthew as he commences his ministry here with us. So no matter what your reason is for coming here this evening, you're all extremely welcome, and we encourage you to stay after the service is finished. Stay around for supper. There's enough supper for everyone. That's in the sports hall, which is just behind this room here, but we'll give you clear instructions about that at the end of our service. Let me introduce myself if you don't already know who I am. My name is Peter Lowther. I usually at that point say, I'm Peter Lowther, I'm the pastor here in this church. But that all changes this evening. I'm going to have to change my line to, my name is Peter Lowther, I'm one of the pastors here in the church. I'm delighted to be able to say that and excited to be serving alongside Matthew. I'm going to commit our service now to the Lord in prayer. I'm going to ask God to bless us as we spend this time together. And after I've opened our service in prayer, I'm going to invite our musicians to come, and they're going to lead us in some songs of praise. So let's join our hearts together, and let's commit our time to our great and almighty God. Let's pray together. Father God in heaven, we want to thank you. We want to praise you. We want to exalt you this evening because you're the great and you're the mighty God. We thank you for the church. We thank you the church isn't just a human invention, not just a social club for people to gather on a Sunday, but this is your plan for your people. Not to continue in their faith as individuals, but to come together as part of local churches, to be taught, to be instructed, to be corrected, to be just encouraged in and built up in this glorious faith. We thank you for this church here, Ballynahinch Baptist Church. We thank you for what you've been doing in and through this church over many, many years. And as we start this new season in the life of church, this church, as Matthew commences in this role as our assistant pastor, we pray for your blessing. We pray that this service tonight might be a real blessing and encouragement to Matthew, and not only to Matthew, to all of us who are here this evening. May our hearts be encouraged. May our souls be strengthened and our faith encouraged as well. And we, as we look forward to what you're going to do here in this town, in this area, in the incoming months and years. We pray as a church family we would come behind Matthew and encourage him and support him. We thank you for the family and friends who have come here. Many people who have had a significant role of encouraging Matthew, being examples and role models over the year. Just the spiritual blessings that so many people here this evening represent in Matthew and Rebecca's lives. We thank you for them, that they can be here this evening to be part of our service. We thank you for the people who have come from our sister church in Dungannon. We thank you for Matthew's service there over 6 years. And we pray, Lord God, tonight that tonight's service, although sad for them as Matthew moves on, we pray might be a real blessing and a spiritual encouragement to him, to them, Lord. But we pray above all things, we pray that the name of the Lord God will be glorified in this place, that our eyes might be lifted. Yes, we have a focus tonight on Matthew and Rebecca, but may our eyes be lifted beyond them to our great and mighty Savior, Jesus Christ. May we make much of Christ tonight in the songs that we sing, in the scripture as it's read and it's explained, through our prayers and through our fellowship together. And may we leave tonight saying we'll never be the same again for how you've met with us, encouraged us, and blessed us. And now, as we continue to worship and praise you by singing songs of praise, we pray, Lord God, that we would do this not just with our lips, but from genuine hearts. So help us, bless us, in the mighty name of Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Good evening, everyone. Before we sing this evening, I wanted to share with you a verse from the Song of Moses, and we find it in Exodus chapter 15. And this is a song he sang when the children of Israel had been rescued from the and they had crossed the Red Sea. And the song says at the start of it that both horse and driver he has hurled into the sea. But this is the verse that jumped out at me. And this is from the ESV version. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. This is my God, and I will praise him, my Father's God, and I will exalt him. And I hope we all have a song to sing this evening, because like Moses, the Lord is our strength, he is our salvation, and we should all have a song on our lips to praise him. So we're going to sing two songs together. One is going to be one of a song of salvation, how the Lord is my salvation, and the other one tells us how he is our strength. So if you're able to stand as we sing, please do join us.
The grace of God has reached for me and put me from the raging sea. On this solid ground, the Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls. I see the dawn of the rising. Thank you.
We just thank you that you are our salvation. As we come before you this evening, we recognize that it was you who first loved us. It was you who rescued us out of the pit. It was you who died for us. And so we exalt you and praise you this evening. And we recognize that this evening is important in the life of Maddie and Rebecca and in the life of our church, but may we never lose sight that it's all about you. Amen. Let's just sing together, "You're My All in All."
Seeking you.
ourselves again. You're my strength.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel. Though to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all.
Please take a seat. We've now come to the act of induction, and the purpose of this service is to set apart Matthew Reid to the ministry of an assistant pastor of Ballynahinch Baptist Church. The Word of God clearly teaches that pastor teachers are a gift of the Lord Jesus Christ to his church. We read these words in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 and 12. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. The duties of a pastor are to be a faithful under-shepherd to the local congregation that is entrusted to your spiritual care. Your responsibilities, Matthew, include feeding the flock by the consistent and accurate teaching of the Word of God in all its breadth, applying it to the needs of the congregation. Caring for the flock by prayer and the exercise of pastoral care and pastoral discipline. Leading the flock forward with other leaders of the fellowship in lifestyle, service, and evangelism by example and exhortation. And so at this point, I'm going to invite Matthew to come forward and join me here on the platform. And if you just want to just stand beside you, Matthew. Now, I need to tell you something, Matthew. This morning, at the end of our morning service, some of the youth in the church, some of the teenagers came up to speak to me, and they were very concerned. And what had concerned them was over the last number of weeks when I've been talking to you, I've been calling you Matthew. And what their concern was, he's not Matthew, he's Matty. And they were concerned we were going to start the wrong trend of calling you by the name. Now, this is the sort of official act of induction here this evening. This is a bit like your wedding vows. And so I'm going to use the proper name, the name that appears on your birth certificate, perhaps the name your mother or your father might call you. So we'll call you Matthew. And after this, then be reassured, young people, we'll go back to Matty at that stage. But Matthew, I'll now ask you the following questions. I'm going to do this in the presence of God and this congregation. Do you believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? And do you personally confess Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord?
I do.
Do you believe the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be the Word of God and the only infallible rule of faith and conduct?
I do.
Do you wholeheartedly and without reservation affirm your belief in the statement of faith of this church?
I do.
Do you believe in your heart that God has truly called you to the role of an assistant pastor of this local church?
I do.
Do you promise to fulfill your charge faithfully, preaching and teaching the Word of God, leading His people, praying for the congregation, caring for their spiritual needs, seeking to maintain the peace and purity of the church, and doing the work of an evangelist?
With God's help, I do.
And final question. Do you promise to be faithful in prayer and in the study of God's Word, and to live in such a way, both publicly and privately, as to be an example to all?
By God's grace, I do.
Great. I'm going to ask the members of Ballynahinch Baptist Church, the members who are here this evening, would you stand at this point of the service? You did this when I was inducted several years ago. I'm asking you to do this again this evening. I'm going to ask several questions to you as the members, because we have a responsibility to Matthew as he comes and commences his ministry here this evening. And the answer to the question is, we do, if you agree with it. Do you, the members of Ballynahinch Baptist Church, believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and do you individually confess anew Jesus Christ as your Saviour and Lord? Great. And the final question, do you receive Matthew Reid, whom you have called to be assistant pastor of this church, and do you promise to encourage him in his responsibilities and to assist him as he labours for your instruction and spiritual growth? And I'll let you take a seat at that stage. And what I'm going to do, just shake your hand and welcome you formally and officially into your role as the assistant pastor of this church. And I want us to speak some of God's word over you, because we read these words in Scripture in the Old Testament. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. I'm going to invite Rebecca to come and join us here on the platform. Matthew has been telling Rebecca all week that she now has to give a 5-minute speech. And I'm going to reassure you can relax at this point. But it's wonderful to have Matthew here and his role as assistant pastor. But it's wonderful to have Rebecca as well, and part of our church family. And we trust that you will feel part of our church family as quickly as possible. When you call somebody, you don't just call one person, you call a family. And so to the members and congregation here, let's welcome Rebecca and Matthew into our church family, as you will, as you have accepted Joanne and myself over the last number of years. Do the same with this pair. And we just want to give you a small gift here this evening, Rebecca. And so I'm going to invite two of our young people, Tilly and Faith, as well. And they have a bouquet of flowers they'd like to present to you. This means you don't have to buy Rebecca some flowers for a few weeks anyway, but always a good practice to maintain as well. And maybe we get your appreciation just by giving a round.
Thank you so much.
But this is a spiritual act that we're involved in, and we want to look to the Lord, and we want to look to the Lord and his blessing here this evening. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to invite our elders. One of our elders, Joe, is out of the country on holiday, but Richard and Stevie are going to join me on the platform now. I'm going to invite them up, and Richard is going to lead us as a congregation in prayer while Stevie and myself lay hands upon Matthew and Rebecca.
Thank you, Richard.
Let's pray. Father, we are a thankful people. We are thankful for who you are, and we recognize that you have brought us as a church this far. And we thank you for your leading and your guiding over these years. We remember the verse that says that there are many, a man may have many plans, but it's your plans that prevail. Mm-hmm. And we recognize that Matthew and Rebecca are here because you called them. We thank you for calling them, and we're thankful that they received that call and humbly and courageously accepted it. We pray that they continue to trust in you, to not lean on their own understanding. Let them acknowledge you in all their ways so that you will continue to make their paths straight. We ask that you'll help Matthew as he starts this new ministry, continue to grow the fruit of the Spirit in him. We pray for Rebecca in her work. May you bless her and encourage her. We pray for her role as a wife. Help her to support Matthew as he supports her. We pray for their marriage. May they be enough for each other in every way. May you be at the center of it. We pray that you'll be with them with any worries about any of the things that they're associated with this, from moving house to the new job, and help them to continue to seek you as their family expands. We pray for Matthew's ministry. May you give him wisdom to know your plans. May you give him patience to go at your pace. May you give him grace for each moment. We pray for him as he embarks on his assistant pastor role. Guide him as he prepares his sermons. Be with him as he undertakes pastoral visitation. Father, we thank you for our youth and for the team of leaders. Thank you for Olivia, who led them, and for Karis, who has stood in the gap until Matthew has arrived. May you continue to grow that group of young people and leaders. Help them to be further rooted and established in their faith in you, so that they may stand firm for you. Holy Spirit, we pray a fresh anointing on Matthew and Rebecca. May you guide them, keep them, and renew them every day. We are a thankful people because we recognize who you are. We recognize that despite our plans and hopes, your will is done, and so you deserve all the glory. And so we pray this in your name and for your glory. Amen.
Good evening. For those of you who know me, it's quite untypical that I will only be up here for a short time. Usually when given the opportunity, I will stay up here for as long as possible. But as I thought about what I would say in response this evening, I really struggled. I was just very humbled by the opportunity to come here. And as I look out in front of me now, I continue to be severely humbled. I thank you very much for those of you who have made their way here tonight to support both Rebecca and I. It's lovely to look out and see family members and those who we sincerely class as our family from several churches, whether that be from the Iron Hall, whether that be from Newton Breda, whether it be that from Dungannon or here in Ballynahinch, as we look forward to our ministry here. And so thank you very much for coming here to support us both. I'd like to thank you specifically for your prayers. I'd like to thank those who have been praying for us for a number of years, praying not just for Rebecca and myself, but even just for me in my youth and in various stages of our lives, as we have planned to leave Dungannon, as we have sought the Lord's will for our lives. I know that many of you have been praying for us. And be reassured that this evening here is the fruit of your prayers. God has answered your prayers as he has done for both myself and Rebecca. And so thank you to those who have known us for a long time and have continued to pray for us. I'd also like to thank Ballynahinch Baptist, specifically at this time, for their prayerful support during this process. I'd like to thank Richard, Joe, and Stevie, and Peter, the elders here. It is unfortunate that Joe can't be here as he's out of the country. No doubt he wants to wash his hands quickly of the decision. We'll say nothing. But again, thank you for your hospitality. Thank you for your encouragement, for your openness and transparency, for the deacons as well of Ballynahinch Baptist, for your openness, for your transparency, for your hospitality, for your encouragement, as both I and Rebecca have sought God's leading during this process. It has helped us immensely, and it has encouraged us immensely, and I again say that it has humbled us immensely. I'd like to specifically thank Peter for his role during this process. At every turn, Peter, you have been very transparent as to where this church was collectively. You gave the elders and the deacons and members, you've given them their proper place during this whole process, and you have kept both I and Rebecca, as nervous as we were, up to date regularly. Personally, Peter, I look very forward to working alongside you. As I've shared the news of the call to Ballynahinch Baptist, be encouraged, Peter, that almost at every turn, people have been encouraging me with your character, of who you are, about how you are full of grace, about your love for the local church, about how you serve as a pastor. And it is a great pleasure to serve alongside you here in Ballynahinch, Peter. No doubt that grace love will be tested as I serve alongside you. But we're in it together now, so I can only apologize. But already this week, Peter, as I've started on Tuesday, I have thoroughly enjoyed serving alongside you here in Ballynahinch. I would again just like to thank Dungannon Baptist. We mentioned, or has been mentioned, how I served 6 years there. And again, for those members who prayed for us there, again, very thankful to all that you have done for us, for both me and Rebecca. You can watch back that live stream if you wish, where I shed multiple tears leaving Dungannon. But to Pastor Richard, thank you for all your support over this last year, for all that you have allowed us to do, for your willingness to serve us as a couple. I would ask and I would challenge you, as you see me up here this evening, please continue to pray for me. Please continue to uphold both Rebecca and I in your prayers. Both of us are very aware that we are only here this evening through the grace, through the love, for the mercy of God. This is not anything that I have achieved or anything that I have managed to come about through my own ability. But believe me when I say it is only through the grace of God that I stand before you this evening. It is only through your prayers and your answered prayers that I am here this evening. So please continue to pray for us. Ballynahinch Baptist, I encourage you please to uphold me and Rebecca in your daily prayers, asking for wisdom, asking for discernment, asking that our attitudes would reflect that God whom I so look forward to serving in this church alongside you. I'm going to invite Alison up just to continue to lead us in worship. And so I'll invite Alison up now, and I'll actually pray just as she comes. God, we do thank you just for this church. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness to it, and we thank you, God, that you are a God full of grace who continues to pour it out upon us. And Lord, we thank you for the fellowships, the churches that are represented here tonight, each who have had a part in both my life and Rebecca's life. And we ask, Lord, that you would encourage them as they see a former member of their churches and seeking to serve you. Lord, the fruits of their labor, Lord, may it encourage them to continue to serve you, continue to seek your will, continue to share the good news of your gospel that changes lives. Lord, we ask that you'd continue to strengthen us, for it's in your name. Amen.
Thank you. I asked Maddie if he would choose a song this evening, and as someone who likes to lead praise, I'm sure he could have chosen a whole lot of songs, but the one that he chose was Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery. I'm not sure we've actually sang this before here, so Dungannon folk, if you know it, I hope you're going to sing out. But thank you for choosing this song. It's full of lots of words, so if you're not familiar, and even probably if you are, look at those words that you sing. Thank you for choosing it, because it's all about Jesus and the wondrous mystery of our salvation. And I pray for you, Maddie, that this will be the story of your ministry, both here and wherever you are, that you'll keep pointing people to Jesus. So if you're able to stand, we're going to sing this now. Come behold the wondrous mystery.
In all my
Take your seats. We're delighted that we have friends from Dungannon Baptist who have been able to join us for our service this evening. In a few moments' time, I'm going to invite the pastor, Richard Allardyce, to come and bring greetings and to share a few words from the folks there in Dungannon. But both the churches, Dungannon Baptist and Ballynahinch Baptist, are part of the Association of Baptist Churches in Ireland. It's a group of about 120 children, or children, churches, more than children, churches from right up in the north, right down to the south, all across the island of Ireland. And it's great to have the director of the Association of Baptist Churches, Dave Ramsey, here this evening. And after Richard has shared a few words, I'm going to invite Dave to come and bring greetings from our sister churches. Thank you, Richard.
It's a real joy to bring greetings from Dungannon Baptist Church to our brothers and sisters in Ballynahinch. It is a real joy. And those words we've been singing, to see the Father's plans unfold, speak of redemption. But the reason why it's such a joy tonight for us in Dungannon Baptist Church is we have seen our Father's plans for Matty and Rebecca unfold beautifully. It's been a powerful thing to behold. Some of the church, back in 2017, it's a joy to see Pastor Paul Simpson here tonight, who was part of that vision to bring a youth and community worker to Dungannon Baptist Church. And that vision was so richly rewarded by God over the next 6 years, as whatever was asked of Matty, he trustworthily and faithfully obliged to serve in the church in so many ways. Friends, you have a servant of God here who will serve the Lord. And that's a wonderful gift for this church. But a gift of grace to this church, but a gift of grace he's been to us in Dungannon Church, Dungannon for 6 years, in so many ways, in so many ways. And I suppose what we've seen in our church grow and grow in terms of a gift of grace is Matty's faithful handling of the Word of God. And we have been blessed by his preaching, as have indeed the youth in the church and the children who are so fond of him. And indeed, the relationships that were built up in the church were powerful with those children. And we have seen saving blessings amongst that age group. It's a real joy. And so in August of 2023, whilst the elders of the church were looking at ways that we could somehow keep Matty in Dungannon, Matty announced boldly that he and Rebecca felt led by the Lord that they would be moving on from the church when their tenure ended. And what was amazing to see in the last 12 months in particular was a new way that God was equipping Matty for pastoral ministry, in particular in the qualification and in the character for the office of elder. And to just see the Lord do this has been just a wonder to behold. And then in March, after Matty and Rebecca had faithfully waited for over 6 months with no sign of a call, and the clock is ticking round to the 11th hour, and out of the corner of my eye in the pastor's conference, I see this conversation between Pastor Lawther and Matty, and it's just, this is God. This is God. And just to step back and pray and watch what happened has been a wonder and a joy to behold. Friends, if you look at our website, you still may catch a glimpse of Matty when he joined us. I want to just commend Matty to you sincerely and without reservation by saying, he joined us 6 years ago as a fresh-faced young man. He leaves us as a man of God. But we mustn't forget Rebecca. Rebecca, too, has been a great gift for the church. And indeed, her Christ-like virtues of kindness and humility and generosity have been a blessing through her ministry. Matty and Rebecca, much loved and respected by the church in Dungannon, we are sad to see you go, but we are full of joy at this call from the Lord. And I want to close, as Pastor Lawther has asked me to say a few words to Matty. Well, a few words, I'll make it four. Assistant Pastor Reid, that's not the four. Remember who called you. Remember who called you. Those words were shared with me by Pastor Dennis Lyle before I took up the pastorate. And they stuck with me. They stuck with me. Remember who called you. Remember who called you. Remember who called you when the times get hard. And I share that too, because God is faithful. A year or so ago, you lifted up your hands and you said, here I am, send me. God is faithful. remember who called you. And church, remember who called Matthew here. Remember who called you. I am convinced, we are convinced in Dungannon, that this is the Lord's call. This is the Lord's call. Remember who called Matthew here. Let me close by reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 12. And we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Amen.
Well, it really is a joy and a privilege for me to be here this evening with you in Ballynahinch as Matthew is inducted to the office of assistant pastor. It's lovely to be able to bring greetings from your sister churches. Peter got the number right. Very often people struggle to get the number of churches. So well done, Peter. Top marks. That's great. 120 churches in our association of churches. And really, we're like a big family of churches. We like to support one another and care for one another and share one another's burdens. When a church struggles, we seek to support it. When a church rejoices like you're rejoicing this evening, we want to rejoice with you. And we're a gospel partnership. We like to work together for the sake of the gospel. 120 like-minded churches working together for the sake of the gospel. We can achieve so much more by working together than what we can do by remaining completely independent. So it's a joy to be with you here this evening. And sometimes when we look around us and we look at society and we think times are tough for the Christian faith, times are tough for churches, I just want to encourage you as well that in our association, we see the gospel going forward, particularly in the Republic of Ireland. We have 120 churches. That's the highest number of churches that we've had in our association. We have the highest number of gospel workers. We're seeing another one being inducted in this evening, the highest number of gospel workers that we have known. And we don't say that to boast in numbers. I say that for your encouragement and also to make sure that we give thanks to God and make sure he receives the glory. It's lovely to be here this evening. I remember it at Pastor Peter's induction. I recall on that night there were three inductions across our association, and I had already committed to another induction somewhere else, and I couldn't be here. It was a personal disappointment to me to not be here at Peter's induction. So it's a joy to be with you this evening, and just to see the church and fellowship again with the church, to see the church moving forward together and reaching out and holding fast the word of life in a needy area. And it's a joy to be with you and to see that as well. I want to thank you for all your support as a church of our association. And I want to encourage you to continue playing your part as well. And Matthew, it's great to be able to bring greetings to you. And this is giving me the opportunity to make a public apology to Matthew. And the pastor's conference has already been referred to, and it's got a lot to account for. The pastor's conference, maybe conversations happen there. But also at the pastor's conference on the Monday afternoon, there's a game of football. And Matthew was on the opposing team to me. And I found myself in defense. I was the last man, and Matthew skipped past me onto a through ball. And the mind still was working, but the body couldn't keep up. And Matthew was in on goal, and everything slowed down. It was slow motion, and I went for the tackle. Missed the ball completely, and nearly broke Matty's leg. And if there had been a referee or VAR, I would have had my marching order. So Matthew, I publicly apologize for completely taking you out. But it's been a joy to get to know you this last while when you've been in Dungannon, and also through your time studying in the Irish Baptist College. It's great to get to know you and have a bit of an affinity with you. And I just wish you God's blessing as you seek to serve the Lord here in this place. And if I can just encourage you with a verse from 1 Timothy chapter 4. And it really says this: set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. That's what you're called to be an example. We trust and pray. Please be assured of our prayers for you. We trust and pray that the Lord will bless your ministry here in this place as you seek to serve him, and that the church will know that blessing as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much to Richard, and thank you for Dave's. Think about that tackle. Typical Liverpool supporter, is that what you expect? Yeah. It's wonderful that many of Matthew's family have been able to join us here this evening. In a few moments, I'm going to invite Matthew's father, David, to come and to bring us our Bible reading. And after that, Pastor Colin Cooper is going to share God's word with us. I could say that it's Colin's fault that we're all here this evening. Colin works for the association. Part of his role is to support those in pastoral ministry. Colin basically is the pastor to the pastors, and so on a regular basis, every 6 months or so, I would meet up with Colin and we would have a cup of coffee and he'll see how I'm getting on and what ways he could support me and pray for me. And back in February of this year, I was meeting up for one of those regular meetings with Colin. He was asking about the work and the ministry here in Ballynahinch, and I shared with him that as elders, we'd started talking about the possibility of bringing an assistant or somebody to join the ministry team here, but we had nobody in mind. And straight away, Colin said, there's a guy called Matthew Reid who you should consider. You'd worked alongside him when you were interim pastor in Dungannon. And that sparked that conversation at the pastor's conference in March. And then as it was brought back to deacons and then to the membership round about May time. So Colin, you're the one who suggested the name. Probably at that stage, little did you think, by this stage, October, we'll be standing here with an induction service. So I'm going to invite David now to come and to read God's word, and then Colin to come and share it with us. Thank you.
I was hoping, Peter, you wouldn't introduce me as his father, and I could have got away with being his older brother, but here, obviously, that's not the case, okay? But thank you, Peter. So we're going to turn to the book of Ephesians, Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus. And I would just like to thank Dungannon Baptist personally on behalf of Rebecca's mum and dad, I'm sure likewise, for their love, kindness and support to Matthew and Rebecca throughout the 6 years that they've been there. And I'm sure, I'm convinced that that is going to carry on in Ballynahinch Baptist. So we are at Ephesians chapter 3. We're looking at verse 14. And my wife has insisted that I read this slowly, which I'm confident I'll do, okay? So we're at Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14, and we're reading right to the end of the chapter. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. May God bless the reading of his word.
Well, it's my joy to be here this evening. We thank Maddie and Rebecca for the opportunity to speak this evening. And it's been good to get to know you over the last number of years as well. And we do pray that God would bless you as you begin ministry here. Speaking at an induction is always difficult to know where to go. Maddie's already asked you for prayer for him, as he should. And I simply wanted to do that, to give you a prayer to pray for Matty. And let me give you a bit of background behind this. Just before Matty asked me to speak here, as we're speaking actually in Dungannon Baptist, they asked me to speak on eldership there. And I was just looking at the role of the elder with them. And as you speak and prepare to speak, very often what happens is you spend a lot more time thinking about the Word of God, and pondering and meditating through it than actually what you actually say from the pulpit. And I was reading from Acts 20 that evening. Verse 28 says this, it says, pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock, in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which he has obtained with his blood. And the one statement that has stuck in my head really since then, and I've spent a lot of time thinking about it, and again, I suppose it was God speaking into my own heart, it was that first statement there, pay careful attention to yourselves. That night I quoted from George Mueller, and Mueller writes this as he thinks upon his own life and his ministry. And he said, I saw more clearly than ever that the first great and primary business to which I ought to attend every day was to have my soul happy in the Lord. The first thing to be concerned was not how much I might serve the Lord, but how I might have my soul in that happy state, and how my inner man might be nourished, for I might set truth before the unconverted. I might benefit believers. I might relieve the distressed. I might behave myself as a becomes a child of God in this world, and yet I may not have my soul nourished or strengthened in my inner man. To have a soul happy in the Lord. So I spent a lot of time thinking about that and what that means. And as I did, I suppose the answer to that, and or rather one of the answers to that, actually came out as I read from Ephesians chapter 3, this prayer that David has read for us. This prayer of Paul for the church in Ephesus. And so, Matty, this is my prayer for you as you begin ministry here. Also my prayer for Peter as he continues ministry here. And my prayer for each one of us, because actually as you read this passage, you find that the Paul actually is talking to the Ephesian church. It's not directly aimed towards a pastor or an elder by themselves, but it's actually for all of us. But Mally, this is my prayer for you. You be strengthened by the Spirit. You be rooted and grounded in God's love. And thirdly, you be filled with the fullness of God. It's a threefold prayer. And as I pray that for you, Mally, I encourage you as a church fellowship to pray this threefold prayer for your pastors. See, Paul, as he writes here to the church in Ephesus, in the first three chapters, he's been emphasizing just God's salvation, God's grace, God's mercy towards us. He builds this solid foundation. He's able to say that we're saved by God's grace. Doesn't matter what your background is, that Jews or Gentiles, all part of God's family. God has done that work. And Paul is struck by awe and joy and rejoicing in the grace of God and what God is able to do in saving power through Jesus Christ. And he recognizes in verse 15 that he's able to say that the whole family of God is named by the Father. And because this is the case, he prays for the church. And in verse 14, what he has there, he alludes to the fact that this prayer that he has for the church is a passionate prayer. Very often in Jewish culture and even in the early church culture, if you prayed, you stood to pray. You generally only knelt to pray if you were repenting or if there was something that was really weighty, heavy upon you. And so Paul acknowledges the fact that he is on his knees, he is bowing, that there's a statement of passion, of fervency here, of desire for God to move and work in people's lives. And this prayer that we have here, this prayer to be strengthened by the Spirit, to be rooted and grounded in love, and to be filled with the fullness of God, is a prayer that will strengthen. It will leave us that place where we're relying upon God to move and to work through us. And so as I say, pray this prayer for Maddie. Firstly, a prayer to be strengthened by the Spirit. Verse 16, let me remind you of it, that according to the riches of his glory, he might grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith. We're praying that God would strengthen you by his Spirit. And as we pray that, we acknowledge what we know already. We acknowledge that the Holy Spirit already dwells within the believer. We acknowledge that, as Paul prays, that God has done that work of salvation. In chapter 1 of Ephesians, verse 3, Paul reminds them there, you've already been blessed in Christ with every spiritual blessing. Then in chapter 1, verse 13 of Ephesians, you already have been sealed by the Holy Spirit. God's glorious grace, God's rich salvation is already yours. The Holy Spirit already indwells you. You already are His child. But in saying that, I believe... There's a difference of having the Holy Spirit in us and being strengthened by the Spirit. And having the Spirit in us means that we feel guilty over the wrong things that we do that lead us to repentance. Being strengthened by the Spirit means that not that repentance means repentance, that not only do we repent, but we pray for God to give us the strength to fight temptation. It gives us the strength to say no to sin and to continue to do that work of maturing us. And so what often happens in the believer's life, as you fight sin and temptation and you see the holiness of God more and more so, you recognize that there's more things in our life that we need to bring before the Lord. And it brings us to rely upon Him more and more, strengthened by the Spirit. I mean, having the Spirit in your life means that you're saved. Being strengthened by the Spirit means that you're growing in the Word of God in obedience. Basically, you never stop learning. What would you need in a pastor? Someone who is teachable. Someone who never stops learning. Again, to quote George Mueller again, he said, the most important thing that I needed to do with myself was to give myself to the reading of the Word of God, to meditate upon it, thus my heart might be comforted, encouraged, warned, reproved, instructed, and thus whilst meditating, my heart might be brought into communion with the Lord, being happy in the Lord. Having the Spirit means also that you know you should serve the Lord now. And I think being strengthened by the Spirit means that you're actively using your gifts to serve God. It's the difference between working hard and doing a good job compared with actually coming before the Lord in weakness, relying upon Him and saying, Lord, I can't do this. You've got to work through me. So you are seen as glorious. It's the difference between simply existing as a Christian and compared to passionately worshiping God in all that we do, in every aspect of our life, that our life becomes a demonstration of worship to God, and everything flows from that, whether it's outreach, whether it's care, no matter what it is, it flows from that heart. See, what we need in our churches, speaking generally, is Spirit-filled men and women. Men and women who love the Lord, who are passionate about His Word, passionate about the Gospel, who are relying upon God for everything. And Molly, I know that is your heart. I know that's your desire. And so I say to you, pray this way. Continue to pray this way. And I say to each one of you here, pray this way for your own heart and your life. Pray this way for your pastors, for this church. Don't rely on past blessing. Seek daily to know the strengthening of God's Spirit in your life and the joy of the Lord flowing from your mouth. Strengthened by the Spirit, pray that. Secondly, pray that you be rooted and grounded in God's love. See, as the Spirit strengthens, I mean, the knock-on effect of that in one sense has to be that you be rooted and grounded in the love of God. You know, that God's love would fill your life and your heart. To understand who God is, to understand His greatness, to understand His character, to see Him for who He is, and to fill our minds and our understanding with Him means that We look in and gaze into what he has done for us. And in seeing what he has done for us through his son Jesus, the love of God becomes more and more apparent. You know, the love of God is most gloriously, wonderfully seen in the cross, where God sends his son to die in our place. Take our punishment, take his wrath is poured upon his son so that we are forgiven and cleansed and we become the children of God. The love of God is applied to our life in that moment when we turn to Jesus Christ in repentance for salvation. The Holy Spirit indwells us. That love of God. I mean, as Paul describes this love, he says that this love, it is incredible for us to get our heads around it. Let me remind you of verse 17. It says that being rooted and grounded in love, verse 18, may be strengthened, we have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, to know the love of God that surpasses knowledge, to comprehend this love of God that surpasses knowledge. You get what he's saying there? You've got to comprehend something that you will never understand. Comprehend that which surpasses knowledge. You know, what's he saying here? Well, he's simply saying this, is to spend your life exploring just the vastness, the greatness of the love of God the Father. I don't know about you, but one of the things that I have wrestled with over the years is the love of God the Father. Because as I think about the love of God the Father, a father who sends his son to a cross to die for me, somebody who was his enemy, somebody who has no time for him. I mean, why would a father do that? Let me tell you, I would never do that. I would never do that. I mean, I would do anything except that when it comes to my sons. And as I've wrestled with that, and I've gone through it many, many times in my head, I mean, how could a father do that? And my conclusion is this. My love as a father is faulty. It is sinful. My love as a father is selfish, protecting. I don't really understand what it is to love unconditionally. I mean, God's love is unconditional. My love is fallible. His love is infallible. My love is conditioned on what other people do. And maybe a blood connection, but his love is infinite, it is unconditional, it is beyond my comprehension, his love is divine, and so while I know enough about his love tonight to be saved, there's so much more that I need to grasp, there's so much more that I need to explore to see the depth of his love. This Father's love is incredible. And as Paul reflects on it here, he says it's broad enough for the salvation of all people of every background to be saved. It's long enough to cover and to keep us for the length of our time here on earth and for all of eternity. This love is high enough to mean that we can rise to the very heights of our joys and our delights in his love. And it is deep enough that it will cover even the depths of our discouragements and despair, to cover us even in the face of grief, even in the face of death. Such is his love that surpasses knowledge. You know, it will take eternity to explore the infinite nature of God's love towards us. Paul writes that in Ephesians 2, verse 7. So in the coming ages, he might show us the immeasurable richness of his grace towards us in Christ. We're going to spend eternity. It's going to take infinity. It's going to take eternity to explore the infinite nature of the love of God. So my prayer for humanity is that you would continue to explore that love. The outworking of that, the exploring of that love means that you'll be rooted in his love. And your heart will grow in his love. And the knock-on effect of that, the overflowing effect of that is care, it's grace, it's mercy, it's gospel-centered ministry, it's worship, it's marveling in the greatness of our God before people, whether it's in church or whether it's in the community around us, and that exalts Jesus Christ. So I pray for you, be rooted and grounded in love. Thirdly, that you be filled with the fullness of God. Now, surely, as we pray for the Spirit's power and Jesus' indwelling and the love of God to be our foundation, we must cry that we be filled with the fullness of God. I mean, what else would we want? I mean, we've tasted something of the goodness of our God, of his generous grace towards us in salvation and in so many other ways. We've tasted of who he is, to be blessed, to be part of his family. And so our prayer is that we would seek to be filled with the fullness of God, to be enveloped in the fullness of God, surrounded with the fullness of God. You know, let me put it this way. I think we all know what it means to be so filled with anger at times that we're dominated. Because we're dominated by rage. And the impact of that is, affects your thinking, affects your behavior. Or to be so, like, dominated with joy in our lives that we the expression of that is happiness and the overflowing of that, and that affects our thinking and affects the way that we act towards people. Or to be so filled with sadness because we're dominated by grief. And again, it impacts our thinking, in fact, our behavior. And the prayer here is that we be strengthened by the Spirit, rooted in love, so we're dominated with God, so we're filled with the fullness of God, verse 19, so that our thoughts, words, and actions are impacted because of what he has done in our life. I think that's what George Mueller was thinking when he wrote those words that we quoted earlier. Says, I saw more clearly than ever before the first great and primary business that I ought to attend to have my soul happy in the Lord. And here's why. Verse 20. Now to him who's able to do far more abundantly than we can ever ask or think, according to the power at work in us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Why pray this way? Why pray that you'd be filled and strengthened with the Spirit? Why pray that you would be rooted and grounded in love? Why pray that you'd be filled with the fullness of God? Well, there are many good reasons to pray, but one of the ones that Paul gives us here is that the gifts that we have when it comes to ministry, that they're not enough. They won't take us actually that far. The ability to preach and to teach will not take us that far. The ability to care pastorally and for people will not take us that far. Those gifts will not take us that far. But we have one who's able to do abundantly more than we can ask for or think of. Dale Moody, on one occasion, was told that the world has not yet seen what God can do through a man fully committed to him. He went away from that statement and he said this, I must be that man. I must be that man. And it's that realization that we need God to work. We need God to do that work in our lives and to work through us. It's that realization that we need primarily to have our soul satisfied in the Lord and then to know that, God, you are able. Lord, you work through your people. It's not my effort that saves. It's not my effort to build any church. But my goal is simply this, to live as God would have me live, to serve as God would have me serve, to be strengthened by the Spirit, rooted and grounded in love and filled with the fullness of God. And then if God takes and uses me to do anything, well, that's up to him. That's his doing. And he receives all the worship and the glory for it. And that is the attitude of heart that comes as we pray this prayer. So pray this prayer. As a church, pray this prayer. Let me turn this around another way. I actually think sometimes that the limiting factor in ministry is actually not even our gifts, or abilities, or our skills, or our preaching, but I think often our limiting factor in ministry is the lack of prayer of God's people. And so I say to you, pray this prayer for Maddie, for Peter, for your pastors. Pray this way. Let me finish just with an illustration. Wilbur Chapman, he often told of his experience as a young man when he became a pastor in a church in Philadelphia. His first sermon, after he preached it, an old gentleman came to him and said to him, says, young man, says, you're a pretty good preacher. Says, you preach the gospel, but I want to help you. Chapman is honest, and he says, when he said that he wanted to help me, my first reaction was, what on earth can you do as an old man to help me? But the elderly gentleman, he went on, and he says this. He says, I'm going to pray that God would work through you by his Holy Spirit. He says, two other people have come beside me, and they've covenanted also to pray for you, that God would work through you by his Holy Spirit. And they did. Those three men began to pray. Over a number of months, three prayers became 10, which became 20, which became 50. Later on, almost 200 people met to pray for Chapman before he preached. And he writes this. He says, I went to the pulpit almost every Sunday, feeling that anointing in answer to prayer for those who had faithfully prayed for me. It was a joy to preach. The result was this. 1,100 came into our church by conversion in a period of 3 years. It was the fruit of the Holy Spirit in answer to prayer. So I say to you, pray this. That Maddie would be strengthened by the Spirit. Be rooted and grounded in love. And be filled with the fullness of God. That Christ will be glorified. Amen.
Thank you, Colin. Just as we sing our last song, I just want to remind you again of the verses that I shared with you at the start. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. This is my God, and I will praise him. My Father's God, and I will exalt him. So we're going to finish this evening with a song and with a story as we sing Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. If you're able to stand, please do.
Blessed assurance.
This is my story. This is my story.
our story, that God demonstrated his own love for us in this. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. We are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession. Why? That we may declare the praises of him who called us out of darkness into this wonderful light. Once we were not a people, but now we are the people of God. Once we had not received mercy, but now we have received mercy. And as the chosen people, the church, the bride of Christ, we stand watching and waiting, looking above. May we be lost in this love, how high and wide and deep and long the love of Christ is. So as we sing the final chorus one more time, can we sing it in unity together as the church? Let's sing, "This is our story, this is our song."
This is our story.
Just close our service in prayer, please. Heavenly Father, we just want to praise you and thank you for this induction service. These are exciting times in the life of our church, Lord. Thank you for your leading and guiding, Lord, and calling Matthew and Rebecca to join us here. We're so pleased that they've agreed to join us here in Ballynahinch Baptist Church. Would you help them both, Lord, to settle into our church and our local community quickly? I pray that you will help them as they move house, that everything may run smoothly for them without much stress. I pray that you bless them abundantly in this next chapter in their lives. We pray especially for Peter as he works, or Matthew as he works here with Peter. Thank you for all his gifts and his abilities that you have given him. Help him to always remain dependent and close to you. We ask that you bless Peter and Matthew as they work together. May they have a close relationship like Paul and Timothy. We just want to pray that for both Peter and Matthew. Pray that you will strengthen them by your Holy Spirit, that they will rely on you, God, for everything. Pray, God, that they both will be rooted and grounded in the love of God. Pray that they will be filled with the fullness of God. Heavenly Father, we pray that many people come to know you and grow in their faith through the ministry of Peter and Matty. Help them both as they pastor and care for the people of our church. Now, Lord, at the close of this service, we want to acknowledge that all provisions and good gifts come from you. We want to thank you for the food that has been prepared for us. Thank you for the team that prepared this supper. I pray that you'll bless our time together as we enjoy this food and fellowship. We just ask for everyone here, Lord, that they have a safe journey home. Just want to ask these things in your precious name, Jesus. Amen.
So that's the end of our service, folks. As Peter said earlier, you'll get some tasty food and tea and coffee if you go through those two doors and into the sports hall. And if all the seats at the sports hall are filled, you can move to the front coffee bar, and those seats are softer and better, so you might like that. Okay, folks, thanks for being with us. God bless you.